Hey everyone, my name is Michael and I'm very happy to welcome you to Steinheim, Germany. I'm a laboratory technician here in the quality control lab and I've been working here for 3 years. Our site is specialized on downfilling large quantities of chemicals into small portions for our customers all around the world. Over 1 million bottles are filled every year. Our job in the quality control is to ensure that the quality of our products correspond with the promised quality which is stated on the certificate of analysis. For this purpose, we have a highly trained team and various complex analytical instruments with a large variety of methods. Our equipment is allocated in 3 main laboratories, which I will show you in a moment. What I like most about my job is that there is a huge diversity of chemicals and methods. It never gets boring and you always find a new challenge. Our team rotates between the laboratories to make sure everybody can do everything. But even with the best preparation, chemistry can be unpredictable. So safety is a crucial part of our work and sadly we are not allowed to do explosive chemical experiments. Nevertheless, my job is very exciting. I will now show you the basic principles of our analytical work in the 3 individual laboratories and I hope you will like it. In the first level of our quality control, mainly chromatographic tests are performed. They are used to separate the substances in a mixture in order to determine the actual purity of the mixture. But how does it work? We always have a stationary phase and a mobile phase. The substance mixture is located in the stationary phase. When the mobile phase passes by, the substances are carried along the stationary phase. Depending on their properties, some of the substances are carried along faster than others, resulting in the separation of the molecules. I prepared a very simple animation to show what happens at the molecular level. A mixture of yellow, blue, and red substances sit on the stationary phase. When the mobile phase passes by, the red substance sticks less to the stationary phase than the yellow or the blue ones. In the end, the 3 individual colors are separated. In real life, the whole process will look like this. The separation took nearly an hour, so I used a time lapse for the video. This basic principle is used in this lab to determine the actual composition of substances and to determine the exact amounts in the mixture. Various fancy machines help to achieve this. Our next stop is spectroscopy lab. Here we perform infrared spectroscopy, UV spectroscopy and NMR spectroscopy, mainly to verify the identity of our substances. These analyses make use of the fact that substances can absorb electromagnetic radiation. That means they cannot pass through them. Basically, we can divide the electromagnetic spectrum into 3 main ranges. The visible range, which we can see as light and colors, the ultraviolet range with a shorter wavelength than visible light, and the infrared range with a longer wavelength than visible light. Depending on the substance and the performed analysis, the absorbed radiation will be in one of these ranges. A common method is the UV spectroscopy. It uses light in the visible and ultraviolet range. Based on the amount of light absorbed, we can determine the concentration of a substance. To demonstrate this basic principle, we will measure a substance everybody's familiar with – sunscreen. We put a clean, empty cuvette into the analyzer and measure a baseline. The line shines from left to right where the value of the light which came through is measured. We can see that all parts of the measured spectrum came through. After that, I put a very thin layer of sunscreen on one side of the cuvette. We now repeat the measurement. The sunscreen will block some parts of the electromagnetic spectrum. In this part, little to no radiation is detected on the right side. A sharp decrease of radiation is visible at around 400 nanometers. That's roughly the border between visible and ultraviolet light. Because of that property, it's important to use sunscreen on a sunny day. It blocks the ultraviolet radiation from the sun, which will otherwise damage your skin after long exposure. Our last stop is the wet chemistry. Here we perform all different types of titrations. But what is a titration? With a titration we can determine the purity or the concentration of a sample by reacting it with another substance called the titrant. At a certain point,
All molecules of the sample have reacted with the titrant at a so-called equivalence point. We can determine the actual purity by knowing the exact concentration of the titrant that is used. I prepared a quick example for you. We now put exactly 10 ml of hydrochloric acid with an unknown concentration into a beaker. We also add a few drops of indicator solution. The concentration of hydrochloric acid can be determined by titrating it with sodium hydroxide solution with a known concentration. In our example, it has a concentration of 10%. The sodium hydroxide solution is already in the burette. A burette is a graduated glass tube with a tap at one end for delivering known volumes of a liquid, especially in titrations. In this process, the sodium hydroxide will react with the hydrochloric acid to form sodium chloride and water. We add the sodium hydroxide solution until the color changes. Then we have reached the equivalence point. We can read the used volume of the sodium hydroxide solution on the burette. In our example, 20 ml were required. Now we can calculate the exact concentration of the hydrochloric acid. We multiply the volume of the sodium hydroxide solution with its concentration. Then we divide the result by the volume of hydrochloric acid. Our analyzed sample of hydrochloric acid has a concentration of 20%.
A challenge is to exactly determine when the equivalence point is reached. A simple solution can be using an indicator like in our experiment. An indicator is a substance which can change its color depending on the environment. In our case, depending on the pH value. The sodium hydroxide solution has a very high pH value. At the equivalence point, the pH value drops to 7 and the indicator is changed in color. There are a lot of different indicators, depending on the type of reaction. Therefore, a lot of substances can be tested.
We are now reaching the end of the day as a laboratory technician here in Steinheim. I hope I was able to spark curiosity in some of you and give a good glimpse into our daily routine. Feel free to ask questions in the comment section below. Bye!